What if I tell you that you don't need to observe tide anymore while doing a bathymetry survey? All your depths will be referenced to the ellipsoid. This is called ERS, or Ellipsoidally Referenced Survey. Sounds absurd, right? So what is ERS? In our traditional survey, we are pretty much reliant and dependent on the local datum and the tide, as we need to deduct the tide from the measured depth. In the ERS, we connect all our depths and soundings to the ellipsoid. So in the ERS, we are not measuring the depth. We are trying to measure the separation or the distance from the seabed to the ellipsoid. Sounds cool, right? But how do we do it? So first we need to measure the distance from the GNSS antenna to the echosounder. Say it is A. GNSS antenna will always give us the ellipsoidal height. Suppose this is B, and echosounder will give us the height above the seabed, which is C. Now you combine them all, A plus B plus C, and you get the distance of the seabed from the ellipsoid. Now this B and C is variable. As the seabed depth changes, C is going to change. As the tide varies, again C is going to change. The GNSS height, B, is also variable due to varying tide, heave, settlement and squat. So how this is going to affect the data? Imagine that you are surveying in a flat seabed and the only variable is the heave and the tide. If the vessel heaves up or if the tide changes, the sea component or the measured depth from the echosounder to the seabed is going to change, right? But what happens to the B component? As the GNSS antenna moves up, the B component will decrease by the exactly same amount, right? And as the distance between the echosounder and the GNSS antenna is constant, the tide and heave will practically have no effect into measuring the distance from the seabed to the ellipsoid. So how it is different than the traditional survey? So in traditional survey, we need to apply the tide or deduct the tide from the collected soundings, and our soundings are greatly dependent on the dynamic draft of the vessel. And we present the data on the chart referenced to the local datum or maybe local chart datum. So in the chart, if the depth is written as 10 meter, it will always be the 10 meter no matter what. So if the tide is 0.5 meter, the depth is going to be 10.5 meter. And if the tide is 5 meter, then the depth is going to be 10 plus 5 or equal to 15 meter. But in the ERS, the chart will show you the separation of the distance of the seabed from the ellipsoid. Say the chart is showing you the ERS value as negative 60. And if your underkill to the top of GNSS antenna is say 20 meter and your GNSS antenna is showing negative 30, then your underkill clearance will be 10 meter. Now the GNSS antenna to the kill, the distance remains the same. The only change that will happen is the distance between the antenna to the ellipsoid, and that will change depending on the tide. Let's now look at some of the pros of ERS. So in ERS, we will use a global reference frame or the ellipsoid such as WGS84, and it provides a consistent and seamless vertical reference frame along the entire earth. So firstly, it reduces the errors associated with the tide observation and the local datum. And secondly, it can seamlessly integrate the land and the sea survey data as it uses a single datum. And this will help us into coastal zone mapping and resource management. And thirdly, as this is referenced directly to the mean sea surface, water column and seabed, to the mathematically derived ellipsoid or the datum, it will have an enhanced accuracy of depth measurement. ERS is more efficient as it reduces the need for extensive tidal observation and different tidal corrections. Traditional methods can be labor intensive and very time consuming. It also allows us for a real-time data acquisition and data processing, improving the efficiency for hydrographic surveys. Now, the use of a global referenced ellipsoid makes the data universally applicable, facilitating international collaboration and data sharing. If you have an ERS data, all you need to do is apply the local chart datum to ellipsoidal separation data, and that will give you the depth. Let's now look at some of the cons of ERS. Now, for a mariner wanting to plan a route or trying to enter a harbor which is tide dependent can be a major pain in the back until unless we have the separation model for that particular harbor ready in our hand. So what is the separation model? We are talking about that particular harbor chart datum to ellipsoidal separation model. Secondly, we have to be completely dependent on the accuracy of the GNSS data, especially the vertical component of it. Now, achieving highly accurate GNSS vertical data can be very challenging, and this can be due to the availability or the satellite geometry, the atmospheric condition, or the scintillation effect that can affect the GNSS data. And this is going to be very crucial when a mariner is trying to enter or exit a port and harbor. Thirdly, investment cost of the high precision GNSS system and a specialized augmented system to achieve the high quality vertical component could be a detrimental to some of the people. Next, uncertainty due to vessel dynamics can cause a significant error while carrying out the survey first, and secondly, while using the ERS chart on board a marine vessel. Now, heave and tide may not have much say into this error, as these are the vertical components and this will be compensated by the GNSS antenna movement and the GNSS antenna separation from the ellipsoid. But pitch and roll can significantly change the vertical distance between the antenna and the echosounder, as well as antenna and the underkill. The distance between them will remain same, but due to pitch and roll, the vertical separation between them can decrease significantly. So yes, investing into a good motion sensor is a must for all surveying vessels as well as all the merchant vessels. Last but not the least, the offshore construction projects will face an uphill task into understanding the new concept, and they have to start using a different process for installing offshore platforms and pipeway. A lot of offshore projects are heavily dependent on the instantaneous water depth, like diver or ROV, or installing a subsea structure. So a separate water depth chart in that area is required. So how can we solve all these problems? First of all, we need to carry out a pilot project in the harbor and the nearshore area to chalk out all the details that may exist, all the issues that may exist, starting from acquisition of the data to the processing and to the charting. Next, we need to formulate a standard operating procedure of how to carry out a survey and how to use the ERS data for general navigation. I believe IHO is already working on standardization and specification of the ERS. Next, we need to establish the separation models from ellipsoid to mean sea surface or the mean sea level, and ellipsoid to the local chart datum. Now, ellipsoid to MSS or the mean sea level separation is already available in the public domain. Now, in all ports and harbors, we should establish a local chart datum separation model. In a port, if you already have a benchmark and you know the datum height of the benchmark, then you put a GNSS antenna on top and you measure the ellipsoidal height on top of that benchmark. And that way you can establish the separation, the local datum separation from the ellipsoid for that area. And that should be good within a radius of say 16 kilometers from that particular benchmark. But if you want to use this inside a river, then it will be wise to establish separate benchmarks every 4 to 6 kilometers along the river. But if you do not have a benchmark in the local area, then you can transfer a benchmark from the nearest port, which should be within 16 kilometers. And if you do not have any major port or any benchmark within 16 to 20 kilometer distance, then I suggest you carry out a 30-day tidal observation to establish mean lowest low water or LAT, and use that datum to find the separation model for that particular region. Next thing that we must do is the calibration and verification. Now, regular calibration survey is required to validate the GNSS accuracy as well as the separation models. And data from the ERS needs to be cross-validated by the traditional method or by any other independent surveys. This is to ensure repeatability, consistency and accuracy. So, what is the way forward? In some way or other, we are already using the ERS. I remember using ERS way back in 2006 into a very difficult survey inside a river. Personally, I believe that this is the right time to move ahead with the ERS. Now, airborne LiDAR bathymetry and drone bathymetry, they are gaining popularity today and they are using ERS, but their survey data is referenced to the local data. As more and more technology improves and there is an improvement in AI algorithm, slowly the ERS survey will outperform the traditional way of surveying, as it will save manpower cost, labor cost and time, as well as the data will be much more accurate. So this ERS has the potential to modernize the hydrographic surveying by providing a consistent and accurate vertical reference system. And this can enhance the quality of the hydrographic surveying. And with the advancement of the unmanned survey vessels, very soon in the near future, we'll not need the services of a traditional surveyors. I know I'll live to see that day. I would love to hear what you have to say about the ERS. So please like, comment and share with your friends. And as always, be curious.